What is going on? Dan Fox here. Welcome back to the channel. And today we're going to talk about histograms, specifically the histograms in your camera. One of the tools that might seem overly complicated and nerdy, and one that you might be avoiding using in your camera. So today I'm going to try to make this a lot less complicated and nerdy. We're gonna talk about why you should care about them, how to understand them, how they're useful for exposing your shots, and even a couple ways they can lie to you sometimes. So after posting my last video where I went out and shot the Milky Way, I realized when I got the footage back to edit that during the part where I was talking about using my histogram to judge my exposure, I accidentally kind of treated it like a side point, or like everyone knew what I meant. I know when I was first starting out with photo and video, they were definitely confusing to me. I didn't understand them, I didn't need them. I mean, after all, my camera had an exposure meter in it, right? And it just cluttered up my viewfinder with extra information, so I'd turn them off. Now, I use a histogram constantly to help me judge my exposure, especially for photography. Sometimes I use zebras too, and in videography, you have even more tools to help you with exposure. But we're just gonna stick with histograms today. Don't get distracted, Dan. Histograms. So first, what is a histogram? I think it'll be easiest to explain this first more generically before we dive into the camera-specific version of what a histogram is. So in math, especially in statistics, a histogram is used to provide a visual representation of the frequency at which values occur in a certain range. It's an analysis tool that's often used to help identify interesting patterns in data, and it kind of looks like a bar chart, with the difference being that a histogram groups numbers into ranges of continuous data, as opposed to a regular bar chart, which groups data into categories. So I'm going to show you my screen and give you a super simple example. So for instance, let's say I had these numbers here, and this data is just totally made up. But let's say I was trying to analyze this data about these different students and their test scores. Now, if I had these numbers and I wanted to plot them on a bar graph, it would look something like this. So, you know, each student in this case is a category, and the height of the bar represents the score they got. Now, an important note here is it doesn't matter the order that the students occur in. If I wanted to, I could put N at the beginning or A in the middle, you know, stuff like that. But if I look at the same data plotted in a histogram, you notice it looks similar but different at the same time. So what's happening now is you notice that you can't see the individual students anymore or the exact scores. What's happening is that the histogram is plotting the number of times a score occurred within a certain range of numbers. So I can see here that between a score of 50 and 60, two scores occurred. If I look over here between a 70 and 80, five scores occurred. And the area gives you a quick visual indication of kind of where the weight of these scores are, where the bulk of them are. Now in histogram, I cannot switch these numbers around. I can't put 90 to 100, then 60 to 70, then 50 to 60, et cetera. It has to be a continuous range of numbers. So real simply here, the x-axis, the left to right axis, is your range, and the y-axis, the up and down axis, is the frequency at which something occurs. Now I'm gonna show you what a histogram for photography looks like in a moment, but the reason a histogram is so useful is that it gives you a fluid visual readout of the data that your sensor's seeing. And this is the most useful for getting a reasonably objective look at your exposure when you compare it to the scene. And it's helpful to remember that when you're out in the field, taking a photo is essentially just data collection. Data that you'll have to work with later to make it into the final photo that you show the world. If you put aside the artistic goals of photography for a moment, your goal when you're out shooting is simply to capture the best data you can. So here's what a histogram for photography looks like. Now, a quick note here that this won't look the exact same way on your camera. This is a histogram from a photo editor, in this case, Lightroom specifically. Even though today we're discussing your camera's histogram, it's just easier for me to show it on the computer this way. And of course, these same principles apply to the histogram that you'll find in your photo editor. But in the case of this histogram, it's overlaying not only the luminosity, but all the color channels that are contributing to that. Now in your camera, these will likely be split out. It will look more like this when you're trying to expose. And this histogram, the luminosity histogram, is showing you the perceived brightness across the three red, green, and blue color channels. And then you'll likely have a second set of histograms with the red, green, and blue color channels split out separately. So even though I'm looking at the photo editing version of a histogram here, regardless, it works the same. You have the same two axes. The x-axis, again, the left to right portion here along the bottom, represents your full range of tones. So down here on the left-hand side, you have zero, or pure black. And up here on the right-hand side, you have 255, or pure white. If you've ever had to take a special math class for digital applications like computers or electronics, and yes, that's actually a thing, hours of my life I'll never get back. You recognize this 0 to 255 as covering the 256 values in an 8-bit range. And the histogram on your camera is a representation of what the sensor is seeing in 8 bits, even though your camera is capturing the data at a higher bit rate. And this is because your camera is showing you a histogram based on a JPEG representation of your image, not on the raw file. But we'll talk about this more in a little bit. Long and short, the x-axis represents a range of 256 distinct values from 0 to 255. Now the y-axis, just like in those examples I showed you earlier, represents the frequency of pixels occurring at a particular tonal value. The histogram on your camera is literally converting each pixel to a luminosity value using that weighted average across your three color channels. And then it gives you a readout of how frequently these tones occur. All right, so again, let's use an oversimplified example so I can show you what I mean. So in this case, I'm gonna switch to Photoshop here so I can show you these just very simple images, but show you the live histogram at the same time. So in this image, just a very simple 5 different shades of gray. We have pure black on the left side, pure black on the white side, middle gray in the middle, and variations between them. And you see in the histogram here how it's just giving you 5 spikes. This is for the white, this is for the black, and these correspond to the ones in the middle. Now, let's say I add another row of the same exact image on top here. But this time I'm gonna flip it. Notice how the histogram looks exactly the same. Still the same 5 spikes. That's because it's still the same 5 tonal ranges. And it's irrelevant what order they're displayed in. So now let me give you one more example. And this time we have the 2 bottom rows here are the same as the one you saw before, but I've added another top row. And this time, instead of using the same 5 colors, I've only used 2 colors. So this kind of light gray here, I've tripled up, and this darker gray, I've doubled up. So now what this means is there are more of these 2 colors in this entire image than there are, for instance, of the pure white and the pure black, or even the middle gray. Now, if you look at the histogram, notice how the peaks are different sizes. So you still have down here at the 0 value representing black, up here it's still representing white, you still have all the tones represented, but now you can see what the histogram is doing more easily. It's not only displaying the tones where they occur on the scale, but also a frequency when compared to the other tones. So you can see here that the pure white and pure black are, you know, the same. And then this light gray color, which now we have more of than any other color in the image, has the highest spike. The middle gray, which occurs at the same frequency as the white and the black, shows that it's at the same frequency. And then this darker gray color, while not being quite as many as the lighter gray, still more than the others, has an elevated spike, but not quite as high as the spike up here. So to make sure I'm clear, we have our 5 tones represented, and then the height is the frequency that those tones are occurring. All right, so let me show you a quick example of an actual image with an actual histogram. And I'm gonna change this to RGB here, just to make sure that it's kind of similar to what you were seeing before. And remember how I was showing you in this image right here, you know, just different squares that are different kind of versions of black and white and what they look like on the histogram. Well, if I zoom into this image really far, guess what you can see? Oh, a whole bunch of little squares, a whole bunch of pixels. And essentially your image is just made up of millions of these pixels. And this histogram is mapping the tones of each one of these pixels, man, can't talk today, to a value on this chart. So let me zoom back out here so that you can see the full image again. So what this histogram is showing you right now is not only the distribution between the blacks and the whites of my image, but also kind of where the weight of my image is. So if you look here, first of all, you can tell nothing's touching black. And some of this is because of the way I edited it. I wanted kind of a more soft filmic look, so I just raised the blacks. But you can see here that a lot of this information is bunched down here toward the darker area. So you got the front part of the darker part of my shirt, the shadows down here. My wife's motorcycle is almost all blacked out. Of course, you got my black tires, etc. You get the point. Now, a histogram isn't meant for you to be able to identify the exact number of pixels. Remember, it's a statistical tool. And identifying the exact number of pixels at each range in the image wouldn't really be that useful anyway. This is meant to give you a bird's eye view of your image so that you can look at the image, or in this case, if you're on the back of your camera, you look at the scene, compare it to what you're seeing on the histogram, and the histogram can help you understand kind of the range of tones that your camera is seeing. All right, so I've got a couple more examples here to show you some images with their corresponding histograms. So if I look at this image, this very dark image with the bright mountain in the center, notice how the histogram is mostly pushed down toward the left-hand side. This is telling me that most of my data is down here in the shadows. Now, if I look at the histogram for this image, it's a little bit different. So if you look down here, there's a spike toward the shadows, meaning there's definitely some shadow detail, but there's also an awful lot of detail up here in the highlights. And for example, we're seeing that we have a lot of white clouds, bright sky, etc. So this histogram is pushed a lot more to the right than the last one. And if I look at this image, this histogram is balanced out really well between the blacks and the whites. Like there's data kind of running the entire range of data. While we're looking at this image, I just want to say that there will be many people that will tell you that this is the best histogram, that it's balanced very well from blacks to whites, and that you should try to get all your histograms to look like this. And while they may be intentioned, that's often simply not true. But we'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. So why is a histogram so useful for exposure? Well, histograms give you a more objective look at what your sensor is seeing out of the scene. It's much more reliable than your camera's built-in multimeter, and a lot more accurate than simply judging how the picture looks on the back of your camera. Your camera screen or viewfinder might be set too bright or too dark for the particular scene that you're in. And when you're glancing back and forth between the scene in the back of your camera, it takes a little bit for your eyes to adjust. And so everything you're seeing is a kind of relative brightness. This is one time of that saying, don't trust your lion eyes, is actually true. Your eyes' ability to adjust automatically is partly what makes them so amazing. But with photography, it can often lead to unexpected results. Now, this is particularly true when you're trying to capture bright highlights or dark shadows. Because of the way your eyes adjust and the fact that part of your vision is actually your brain piecing together information, you're capable of seeing a much wider range of tones than your camera is able to. Now, modern cameras are getting better and better at capturing a broader range of light, but they still just can't compete with the way human vision works. So using an objective tool like a histogram on your camera helps you compare what you're seeing to what the cameras see. And it's especially useful for knowing when you're crushing or underexposing your shadows, or blowing out or overexposing your highlights. If you capture data in your image that's pure black or pure white, there's no way to recover that data, because those are the two extremes that your camera can see. So underexposing your shadows and overexposing your highlights are definitely two scenarios that you're trying to avoid. And a histogram will help you know how to adjust your exposure to avoid those scenarios. Now, as I alluded to earlier, it's important to note that there is no single right way to view a histogram. You need to take into account what you're actually seeing. If I go back to these pictures I showed you here, this lighthouse image is very well balanced between the blacks and the whites, but this mountain image is pushed really far down toward the shadows. In fact, a lot of this detail is crushed in the shadows, meaning the shadows are underexposed. But in the case of this image, it was night out. And so I'm fine with losing details in the shadows because my subject is the mountain, not the shadows in the trees. Another common example is if you're trying to expose for a person's face, but the sky behind them is really bright. This is where your vision as an artist comes into play. You're gonna have to make a choice. Do you want to expose for the subject or expose to protect the highlights? Both of those come with pros and cons. So both of those images I showed you before are exposed well, despite the histograms looking vastly different. So remember that a histogram is a tool to help you make decisions when you're using your camera. It shouldn't be something that is telling you what you have to do. And as you get to know your editing program and your camera better, that information will factor into how you use the histogram for exposure too. And this is a perfect segue into my next point. Histograms can lie to you sometimes. They definitely aren't a perfect tool, and there are some caveats that if you don't understand may make you come away with some bad information. So the first is, remember how I told you that your histogram on your camera is a JPEG version of your raw file and not showing you your actual raw file. This means that the histogram on your camera is oversimplifying or compressing the tones in your image. If you're shooting raw, and you should be, you'll have extra room on both the shadow and the highlight side to recover more information because you're shooting in raw. So your histogram is a bit more of a conservative look at your scene than what your sensor is actually seeing. Now, this is useful to know when you find yourself needing to really push the limits of the blacks or the whites. But this also means you need to get to know your camera. Take test shots of a scene. For your first set of shots, underexpose. Push those shadows all the way down. Your next set of shots, overexpose. Push them as far to the right as you can. Then bring those into your editing program and compare what the histogram on the back of the camera told you with what your editing program is telling you. Because your editing program can see the full range of data of your raw file. So if you play with your exposure in the editor, you can see how many stops of extra latitude you have over what your camera told you you had. And this will be useful information for the next time you go out in the field. You think maybe you're pushing your exposure a little bit too bright, but then you remember, oh, I have 1.6 stops of extra latitude that I can expose this image before my whites are actually blown out. So another way your histogram can lie to you has to do with the way it averages out your different color channels to display your luminosity histogram. And this will be the main histogram you use to expose with. So what can happen sometimes is you look at this histogram and think you've exposed well, but you've actually clipped one of your color channels. Now, an example of when this might happen is when a particular color is really dominating your scene, like a sunset, for instance. If you're getting a lot of that nice golden orange light, you could accidentally clip your orange channel. You could accidentally clip the red channel without realizing it. Now, a simple way to correct for this is to compare your histograms while you're in the field when you're in a scene where there's a strong color cast. So you expose first with your luminosity histogram, that's the gray one. And once you take your shot, you'll get access to a more accurate set of red, green, and blue histograms. If you've accidentally clipped one of your channels, just go back and take the shot again, slightly reducing your exposure. And you just do this back and forth until you're sure that you're not missing any data in one of your channels. And once you do this enough times, you start to learn kind of when this is likely to happen. And again, has a lot to do with your gear. But nothing can be more frustrating than thinking you get a really good exposure in camera, get it home to your editing software, and realize that one of your channels has unrecoverable data. All right, so what I'd like you to do is if there are other topics like this, things that maybe you're having a little trouble understanding and that we can try to figure out how to break down in a more simple way, please head down to the comments and let me know. And make sure while you're down there, you leave a like. And if you're wondering what video to watch next, check out this video right up here. Later on.